Excited that you are joining us this morning for our online service. But before we begin, I just have a couple of really quick announcements. Last week, we started our drive-by drop-off pancake kits. So let's check out this week.
Alrighty, we are going to see three families today. We are going to see the DeYoungs, the Bifuses, and the Diffies. We are so excited for this week's drive-by drop-off, so let's get to it.
Here we go.
Hey,
how's it going?
This is not a video day.
oh, it's all good. It'll...
So, it's going well. Thank you so much for the pancakes. Yeah, Justin will be very happy. He likes his pancakes.
Awesome. Good. Right, is there anything that you would like to say to the community church family?
Miss you guys. Miss everybody. And hopefully we'll be able to get together again soon. So, that's about it.
Awesome,
it was
so nice seeing you.
You too.
It was good seeing
enjoy
you. Bye.
Okay, here we go.
Excited to get back, and eventually down the road maybe we'll be able to get some free babysitting out of the church as well.
Is that an announcement? Is that an announcement right there?
Oh yeah, you know, just packing on the
we're adding
isolation.
Madeline's excited for the kids ministry to grow.
Definitely.
So exciting. Well, enjoy your pancakes.
Thank you very much.
We're very excited.
Sweet. So good to see you guys.
See ya.
Bye.
Hello. Hi, Jack. How are you?
What's
up? Jack, how are you?
Hi, family. Community Church. How are you? Thanks for coming this morning. Thanks for being here, and I love you.
We miss all your faces a lot.
Well, some of your faces, not all.
No.
All of them.
Stop talking about Craig like that.
Yeah, exactly. Oh gosh, look at that, eh?
Cool. Well, now you get to enjoy some pancakes.
That's awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I wonder if
we're
gonna
be
able to get together.
Hi.
Bye.
Hi, bye. What?
Awesome. Well, wasn't it so good to hear from just part of our community church family and stay connected a little bit? If you would like a drive-by drop-off pancake kit, just send an email to office@communitychurch.ca and we will be sure to get you one. We also have some really exciting news. We have been given summer student grants for this summer. Super exciting. So if you would like to be a summer student, just send your resume to jonathan@communitychurch.ca and we will be in touch with you. We also are in need of a little bit of lawn care here at the church. So if you are able-bodied and interested, just send an email to jen@communitychurch.ca and she will be in touch with you as well. Finally, your ways of giving today are online on the church website or curbside drop-off here at the church. That's it for me. Let's get back into worship.
Thank you. storm surrounding me, let it break, and your name still, call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave. Make the darkness tremble.
Hi community, my name's Cody, and here's a glimpse of how Jesus has worked in my life. It's a story of perseverance, patience, and knowing that God's time is truly perfect. When I started my company, I had no doubt that it would be successful, sustainable, and would be able to provide for my family. For the first 4.5 years of grinding, I worked a full-time, 9-to-5 job and had a 2-to-3-hour commute each day. I would use all of my vacation days and sick days to do bigger jobs, and most weekends were used to grow my business. Throughout those 4 years, there were glimpses and opportunities where I thought, this is it. I can quit and I can go full time. Those opportunities would fizzle out and wouldn't be quite what I expected, and they wouldn't sustain a business. I was starting to get discouraged and frustrated and couldn't understand why all this hard work, why it wasn't happening now. To start 2019, I'd used all my vacation days to work various events, and going into summer, I had no time to use even if I needed it. Work was coming faster than I could handle on a part-time basis, and soon I'd have to start turning things down. On top of it, the company I worked for was going through changes, which wasn't allowing any flexibility with any of my scheduling. With everything shaping up the way it was, this is my chance. This is my sign to give my notice and go for it. God's timing is perfect. After my last day, we took the weekend to go to a cottage. When we got home, I went the next 4 months with only a couple afternoons off. And new jobs kept coming out of what seemed like nowhere. This allowed comfort in my slow season and to have more family time than we have probably ever had. God's timing is perfect. Fast forward to COVID. I now have the flexibility that I didn't have before. Hillary can work from home, and there never has to be any worry about Kylie or Everett needing childcare. God's timing is perfect. If I went with my timing, I would have crashed and burned in the first year. Jesus had a plan. Thankfully, I listened. His timing made it possible. With all of this, I always go back to Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap harvest and we will not give up. God's timing is perfect. This is my story. What's yours?
Awesome. Hey, community, we want to welcome you again. And man, I just want to say thank you for joining us today on our Sunday and our gathering and worship. I trust you had a good time today already in the presence of God. And we're praying and believing that the presence that you have felt in your homes, you're going to continue to sense and feel as we have this conversation today with our special guest, Jason Randall. And I'll introduce Jason in a second. But hey, Jason, yeah, go ahead and wave. There we go. And we're glad to have Jason as we have this crucial conversation with our church family, with one of our own family. Jason is a church planter that we've been supporting. He and his wife, DeLaby, planted a church, Forward Faith Church, in the Trinity Bellwoods area. And so we've invited him to share just his heart about this this incredible conversation and needed conversation about racism and how we as the church, as followers of Jesus, need to respond. So we're going to get to that in a second. But I just want to remind any of our parents, as we've shared every week, that you would go ahead and just hit pause on the video for a second so that you can go to communitychurch.ca. And under the Kids tab, you can go ahead and click that, and there'll be stuff there for your kids to do as far as, you know, on another computer, tablet, mobile, while you sit back with your coffee and enjoy this conversation. And I hope and pray that you will learn something today, that God will stir your heart to action and to prayer. And so we're going to get to that. So go ahead, parents, and pause. For the rest of us, get ready for an incredible conversation. So for all of us that have stayed tuned here, like I said, we have Jason Randall from Forward Faith Church. And I got to tell you, you guys all know this. I've said this when I first introduced Jason to community, that the first time I met him, man, just kindred spirit, kindred heart. I love my brother. I love his passion for Toronto and just his desire to serve Jesus in this way. And of course, his wife, DeLaby, and their son. And so Jason, we're so glad to have you. Probably a good place to start is to actually ask Jason how it's been going to plant a church during a pandemic. So Jason, how is it going so far? And then we'll get into obviously the main part of our conversation today.
Well, you know what, thank you so much, Craig, for that nice introduction. And yeah, it's been challenging, but it's definitely been exciting. My team, we've tried new strategies, and ever since it happened, I've known that all other churches and other church leaders have gone through this whole transition. That so now we've been focusing more on digital and also more on community, even though we're still practicing our social distancing. So it's definitely working out. We started a singles group that seems like it's going very well, and so we're making it happen. And I learned a long time ago in life and ministry, there's always surprises, there's always shifts, there's always changes. So I've learned how to just kind of roll with everything that goes on, and it's just something that just keeps you prayed up. But we're still moving, and once things kind of slow down a little bit, we still plan on getting up everything set up and up and running later on this year. So we're definitely excited. I can't wait to open the doors whenever the right moment hits.
Yeah, man, and we're excited for you too. And as many of you know, like I said, Jason's been planting a church in Toronto, but he's actually from the U.S. and he's originally from Pittsburgh. And so Jason, you know, obviously in light of what's going on in the States right now, you know, how's your family doing? You know, what are your general thoughts before I get into just some of why we're having this conversation today? But what are your general thoughts right off the bat?
Well, just thinking about my family, it's definitely good to hear everybody's going well, even with COVID-19. Things are looking and seem like things are still progressing. Everyone's healthy. Those who are working, they're still working. So family's doing good. My family's doing well. Family in the States is doing well, which is awesome. And even just my thoughts about the States right now, it's very interesting because I think about it like being an open wound. And for such a long time, it's been exposed and hasn't been addressed. And I'm kind of excited just the fact that we're starting to see protests and many people who are fighting for social injustice. So this part is kind of exciting. Obviously, the sad part about it is seeing, you know, certain people who are dying, possibly even being murdered. That's always a sad thing for Christians, for us to see people to get killed in any circumstance. But other than that, I just talking with people, seeing images and hearing what's going on in many other cities, it seems like that there is a stir for possible change, which is always a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I think obviously last week when, or I guess it'd be more than last week, it's been a little longer than that, with the incomprehensible and despicable treatment. Yes. And that led to the death of, you know, George Floyd in Minneapolis. Of course, what happened to Ahmaud Arbery, you know, just before that. I watched the video. I wish in some ways I didn't, because it broke my heart. But, you know, as I watched it, it just really bothered me. And, you know, I guess one of the things that bothered me is the fact that, you know, the treatment was just, it was despicable. And I sat back and I was like, I want to do something, but, you know, what do I do? And anybody that knows me knows that I'm a bit of a processor. So I don't like to just like jump on things or say things. I like to just kind of process. And so I began the process, and I didn't feel like this past Sunday, you know, preaching a message on it, because to be quite honest with you, I really didn't feel ready because I was still processing my thoughts. I knew how I felt, but, you know, what do you do? And I didn't even feel like a message would, you know, be enough, to be honest. And I didn't feel like it was my place to really speak to it. But I also felt like I can be a conduit. I can use the platform that I have to be a part of the solution, because silence is not an option. And you know that, and I know that. And so I began the process, and I felt like the place to start was to listen. That was what God laid on my heart. Just listen. And in fact, I intentionally entitled this conversation that we're having today, the promo that went out earlier this week, you know, is to lean in and listen. And the reason why I said that was because you and I both know that when you're talking to somebody, and everybody else watching this right now knows what I'm talking about too, that when somebody leans in to a conversation like I'm doing right now, that subtle physical shift in your body language communicates something very powerful to the person that's talking. What it says to them is, I'm trying to hear you. I want to hear you. I'm interested in what you are saying. I'm not just listening, but I want to grasp what you're talking about. And I really feel like, you know, when someone does that, it really gives a sense of confidence to the person that's communicating, that they know that they're being heard. And I think we need to have a subtle shift that can have a powerful impact on this conversation, that we would actually lean in as the church and listen. Why? Because when you're having that conversation and you're really capturing, you know, that's where the Holy Spirit, I think, works and begins to speak to us about, you know, how we can be a part of, like I said, the solution. And I get it. Like, this conversation's not an easy one. I was telling Jason, you know, earlier in the week when we were mapping this out, that it's a tough conversation to have, you know, because you don't want to say anything, especially on my part, you know, being white. I don't want to say anything that's going to come across the wrong way or unintentional, or not so perfectly. And because I really want to capture, you know, what's being said, and then I want to process it and go, well, what can I do to be a part of, you know, dealing with something that has gone on way too long. And so it's got to start with, you know, what a lot of people are saying on social media. It starts with the conversation. And Jason, you know, I want to say this because I'm going to read a quote here from a goaltender in the National Hockey League. And Jason and I were kind of laughing about this, right? And he's from Pittsburgh, so I know he knows hockey, man.
Like Sidney Crosby.
That's right, guys. You know, and of course, you know, Canadian boy. Here we go. And so I want to, you know, read a quote from Braden Holtby, goaltender from the Washington Capitals, because he said something that really resonated with me, and I wanted to use it as a platform. But before I share, you know, one of the things that Jason and I have been talking about this week is to set the tone for this conversation. I think it's important for us to make this clear that it's not that, you know, all white people are racist, because we know that they're not, but there are some that are. And there are, it's not that all police officers or the police force is, you know, violent or aggressive, but there are some that are. And it's not that all people that protest are wanting violence or looting, but yes, there are some that will do that. But there are some that are, you know, peaceful, and they're protesting because they want their voice to be heard, because they want to see change. And just like there are some white people like myself that wants to make sure that my brother, that he knows that he's loved and valued, and I see him as an equal follower of Jesus, a human being. And so, Jason, do you want to comment on that? Because I know we've talked about it, and then we talked about the roots of Azusa Street. Do you want to jump in there with that, or do you want to pick up that a little bit later on?
Well, you know what? I could just go into Azusa Street right now. I think that's a good landing point. Yeah. So just thinking about Azusa Street was an amazing point in history, because, for example, one of the reasons why me and you, Craig, are sitting here right now is because of the Azusa Street experience. And the whole experience happened because there were a group of people from other races. You had black, you had white, you had Latinos in the United States, in the Los Angeles area, that wanted a deeper walk with God, who wanted to experience with the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues. And so what happened was, mainly the whole experience started in 1906 by a blind black preacher named William Seymour. And he was being taught by Charles Parham. And so Parham left off for a little bit, and that's kind of good because of his thinking that I might talk about later on. But anyway, what happened was that all of a sudden, people started to get filled with Holy Spirit, and the revival went on for years, and now we have Pentecostal churches all over the world just because people were able to put everything aside and worship together. And so that's why it's so important that the church is able to come together, and that the church is the example of love and community, and also that is able to allow things to happen. I honestly, truly believe many people refer back to Martin Luther King when it came to civil rights, because he was the one who was able to start the nonviolent movement, you know, and push social injustice, and also to bring people together. And so it was him spearheading the whole movement in the States for civil rights that has allowed many people to have civil rights all over the world.
Yeah, you're right. And we've talked a little bit about that, and we'll probably get into a little bit more of Dr. King's influence, right? Influence, like major impact. I mean, anyways, great admiration and respect for Dr. King. So then, to my point, today is about us leaning in and listening. And I love what Braden Holtby said. This is just a portion, a snippet of what he actually said in his statement, but it resonated deeply, because I feel this way, and I want you to know that. I want all of my extended family in the Lord, my community, my friends to know, you know, people that are, and it's not, and we've talked about this, not just the black community, it's all races, that you would know that you're loved and valued. And I love what Braden Holtby said I couldn't say it any better. He says this, as a person who definitely falls into the white privilege category, I know I will never truly know what it is like to walk in a black man's shoes. But I know that I have arms, I have ears, I have a voice to walk beside and to listen to every word of anguish and give my strength to every black man, woman, or child. I love this part. Until their shoes weigh the same as mine. And so, Jason, as a church, I invite my congregation, my church family, to now sit back and actually not sit back, lean in and listen to a brother in the Lord share his heart about racism, how it's impacted him, how it's impacted his community, and what we as followers of Jesus, as human beings, need to understand so that your shoes weigh the same as mine. And so, my friends, I leave it to you, which the first question we talked about was, what do we need to know about racism?
Well, you know what, Pastor Craig, I think sometimes just starting from the very beginning, and what I mean by that is, like, what is racism? And so basically the definition for it is prejudice, discrimination, antagonism directed against anyone of a different race based on their belief that one's race is superior. So typically when we think about racism, racism is dealing with a majority who has economic backing and it typically has political backing and is a place that that they actually are over a country or a nation. So for example, obviously here in Canada, that's how obviously the white society would be more so over. Now, if you're in a place like Ethiopia that is mostly black, then a black person could be racist in Ethiopia, for example. So that's pretty much what it's about. And one thing is that I think even right now with the news, everybody is seeing what's going on in the United States and from the United States. And so I think some people in Canada will say, oh, well, you know, well, okay, racism really doesn't exist in Canada, or that might be their perception, but it actually does. And so I just wanted to go over some stats, and then I want to go over some ways for us as the church to kind of combat it and kind of come together in unity. So here we go. So for example, a black person in Ontario is 20 times more likely to be killed by the police. Okay, First Nation in Manitoba are 6 to 7 times more likely to be incarcerated by whites. Also, third generation blacks in Canada average, they make about $37,000 a year to opposed to whites who make about $48,000 a year. All right, and just one more stat, black unemployment is about 12.5%, and for whites it's about 7.5%. Okay, so basically, from my learning and understanding about racism here in Canada, is that typically it's geared towards Blacks and First Nation. Those are the majority when we're discussing about racism here in Canada. And obviously, there's a big term that's been going around. A lot of people have been talking about it recently, and that is systematic racism. So what is systematic racism? So basically, systematic racism is that there are actually systems that hold back minorities. And there's actually a very nice, it's about a 4-minute video on YouTube. I wish I could share it, but it just kind of breaks down everything. And I'll kind of explain it right now. So basically, here in Canada, that's dealing with schools, education, jobs, and housing. And so what all this means is that, for example, let's say that a person grows up in a certain school, a low economic school from their neighborhood. And what happens is they might not have the best teachers, or their teachers might not be willing to push them to exceed and to excel. So, okay, if that student, if they go and they graduate, now they maybe they have enough money to go to university. They may or might not be able to have a scholarship, but let's say they go. So, okay, now they get through. But they might struggle. They might have to have some loans because maybe their family does not have that financial backing to make sure that they're able to go through school to not have to pay student loan or these type of debts once they're done. All right, so let's say they graduate. So after they graduate, now, possibly because of their name being too ethnic, some of the headhunters or the people who are in the position to hire them might not hire them because of their name, because their name might not be of the majority. So, okay, so let's say, all right, eventually this person gets a job, they're working, which is good, which is fine. But then also with housing can be a challenge as well. So there's all these systems that can possibly hold down certain minorities. Now, one thing that's important about systematic racism is that there's so many areas that you necessarily can't point at one person or one organization. So it's important that everybody is aware of systematic racism and that everybody is working to improve it and to make it better. And one of our jobs as the church is to help and assist in these areas so that that if we see people who are being marginalized or else if we're experiencing people who, I don't know, maybe someone might be a teacher on this call, and maybe that is your job. Maybe that is your position to help students learn and actually understand what mathematics or maybe what English is. So everyone has different roles, and everybody can have different parts to kind of make sure that we're able to combat racism.
Yeah, and I think that's what we were talking about the last few days, you know, just about how everyone has a role. We have a part that we can play to be a part of the solution to bring about reconciliation, and again, you know, like whether it's discrimination, racism, the marginalized, you mentioned that too, right? Like it's all a part of it. You know, one of the things that came up in our conversation had to do with fear and how, fear, because fear plays a big part in it, right? Like, you know, again, even when you're having a conversation like this today and it's going out on social media, it's going to be up right on YouTube. And of course, you know, you're not afraid to have the conversation. Again, like I said to you, you just want to make sure you do the right thing and really reflect, really be able to convey your heart, you know, properly. But fear plays a big part in racism, at least in our conversation, that's what came up. Do you want to expound on that a little bit?
Yeah, and I think one of the issues, one reason why people fear, there's a quote from a couple of people that says that people fear what they don't understand. In many ways, people fear something that they don't have experience with, that they don't associate with, or they don't know. If you're walking down the street and if someone gets close to you, you don't know that person, so maybe fear might resonate on you, or it might be the first thing that comes and jumps in your mind. And so I think a lot of that comes from different type of stereotypes that we might have from various races. And so it's important that in our everyday walk as a Christian, that we are able to not necessarily live by our negative emotions, but for us to operate by the Holy Spirit and most of all from God's word. And even the example that I can give today is in 1 John 4:18, such love has no fear because perfect love expels fear. If we're afraid, it is for fear of punishment, and it shows us that we're not fully experienced his perfect love. And some of those versions I've read that our love is perfected. And so when people are confronted in certain areas, and I think the issue is that when we talk about racism and fear, this is the fact that people are faced with someone and they say, okay, all right, maybe this person is bigger than me, there's fear, or maybe this person might take my job, there's fear, or, you know, maybe, you know, this people, they might terrorize my country, there's fear, or, you know, there's so many areas where there can be fear. And we know and we understand that is a negative emotion. And so it's important that that's something as Christians, we're able to manage that. And even me personally, I've had some experiences where people have called the police on me out of fear, but I was the nice guy, I was working. So And it's important for us to see and realize that, okay, you know, everyone has their place in society. And so we have to watch ourselves and be careful that we're not prejudging somebody. And if we never really know who they are. And there's even been times in my life that, okay, I'm by somebody and I can tell maybe they feel uncomfortable. I'm like, hey, hi, how are you? And then we start talking and I can tell that the level of fear starts to go down because now there's the dialogue that goes there. And even, for example, you know, Pastor Craig, I mean, we kind of talked about this before, for example, with we're just wearing a hoodie, you know, I like hoodies, especially on a windy day. It's the GTA, the Toronto area. Their hoodie weather lasts for a very long time. Yep. So, I mean, you know, having a hoodie on in certain times of the year is normal, but you might be able to wear a hoodie and people will look at you one way. And if I wear a hoodie, people might look at me in a complete different way. And so it's important that we're able to notice these certain things and that we're able to walk in love instead of fear. And so love, we understand as a Christian, is that action to say, you know, spark up a conversation with somebody. Hi, how are you? I mean, there's so many walls that can drop down when we're able to discuss things to our brothers or our sisters, even people that we don't know. I mean, maybe there's a new neighbor who just moved next to you and, you know, they're a visible minority and, you know they are. And now you have an opportunity to find out who they are. So one thing that I did write down on my notes, which is very true, is the fact that the Bible tells us that when fear comes on, that we should cast it out. You know, that we should allow God's spirit and God's thoughts to take over so that we're not able to prejudge people and get them put in tough and bad situations.
Yeah, you know, and it's interesting you say that because I was reading up on some, like, just some articles, different things, and one of the articles I came across was a study that came out of Berkeley. And so I'm not sure how long ago this was, but something that grabbed me in that conversation, I believe it was from Berkeley anyways, but something that grabbed me was some of the statements that that are made daily for some. And you talk about fear because fear goes both ways, right? You just mentioned the hoodie thing, right? Like wearing a hoodie. I can wear a hoodie and people not necessarily see it a certain way. But if you wear a hoodie, you know, it could invoke some sense of fear for some people. Not all people, but for some people. Absolutely. You know, like, so for example, like, and I read this and it grabbed my heart because I'm like, as a follower of Jesus, I would never want anybody to feel this way, no matter who they are, right? Yeah. So, you know, things like this, within the Black community, it is not uncommon to hear or think statements like, I think when I go out every day, some situation is gonna happen as far as my racism.
Right.
Or, you know, I think about race all of the time, everywhere I go, all of the time. I feel depressed. Here's another statement that came up in that study for Berkeley that was a common statement. I feel depressed at times when dealing with that stuff, meaning racism, on a daily basis. The last one that really grabbed me was just what you said about the hoodie. It starts to wear on you where you get depressed and you start thinking bad thoughts and wondering if you're really a valued part of society because people, you know, have this. Some people, I'm going to say that very clear. Right. Some people have that perception, and I think that's really important. Some people, you know, so yeah. So, but part of that journey of, because that bothers me. I don't want anybody. Right. And like I've shared with Jason, I grew up in a multicultural church, and I can't tell you how blessed I honestly think I am to have done so. And I'm so grateful that my parents were a part of a church where there were so many other cultures and nationalities that were represented there, and all of my friends and the connection and the laughs and just appreciating and valuing everybody's culture. And I said to Jason this week, and I've said this to my wife so many times, that for me, for my kids, I wish they had the blessing that I had. But in our conversation, you just said that's part of the journey. That's one way that can help us, because I know, like I said, it bothers me that anybody, especially the Black community, would feel that they can't go out without potentially encountering some kind of racism. I would never want anybody to feel that way. And in my headspace, I don't even think that way, but I think part of it is because, you know, as far as, you know, when I see somebody else of a different race, I don't think that way. I think part of it is because I grew up in a multicultural church. And so one of the things you talked about was exposing our children or ourselves to different cultures, and that being a catalyst to helping us get beyond things like fear and how we treat people, and maybe even discovering some of our own prejudices and dealing with them that are deep rooted that we don't even realize are there. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, sure. And when I think about exposure is when we're able to be exposed, it gives us a chance to operate in love. And also it gives us an opportunity to meet other people. I think in one of our conversations, I was saying how I've been blessed to have a lot of deep conversations with almost every different type of nationality, you know, whether they be Arab or, you know, Asian, white, Asian, white, Latino, et cetera, Indian. And just having those conversations, you see every people are just people. You see, everybody's the same. People are concerned about their family. They're concerned about their finances. They're concerned about their peace and their well-being. Everybody's the same. But one of the blessings is the from our cultures is our culture. I'm an African American man. I love Italian food. I like sushi. Being from Pittsburgh, there's a large Polish community, so I like Polish sausage and pierogies, and I like, you know, obviously soul food from America, jerk chicken, and so Indian food. So basically the point I'm trying to say is that God has allowed all these cultures to be on the earth for certain reasons, have added into humanity in so many different ways. And so it's important for us to experience different cultures, different people. And also it gives us an opportunity to really be a part of something. So I think sometimes we have to be intentional. Now, obviously, I know everyone lives in different places, some neighborhoods and some communities, there might not be any minorities, or it might be just one group of people, and that's understandable. It might just be one race. But when there's other races, I encourage us to be intentional about reaching out to other people. You know, go out to dinner, go out for coffee, go just like what you're saying, expose your kids to someone else, have them, you know, let your kids play, enjoy. I mean, and this is the beauty about it, and even about us being here in the GTA, that the fact that there are so many nations and so many cultures that we can kind of expose ourselves, because if we're around other people, it's hard to be prejudiced. If you know a certain culture, it's hard to be prejudiced. So I might be from the Black culture and my wife is Latino, and I've learned so much more about her culture by being married. And, you know, I understand food, I understand language. And so all of this is from exposure. And that's why it's so important for us. One way for us to combat is for us to have friends from other races and to be intentional about it. And it's really important. It is key.
So on that note, you know, talking about what's key, I mean, because I agree with you, like exposure is huge. And so, you know, like you, as you can tell, I enjoy food, so that's not an issue for me. I'm not so much on the sushi side of things, but
gotcha.
I know, and everyone keeps telling me I'm wrong, but anyways, I get it. But like you, like enjoy so many other kinds of food and the culture. It's so rich and it's fun. Like it's just amazing. And when you live in the GTA, you have that opportunity. You have the opportunity to really experience, you know, other cultures, food wise, entertainment wise, whatever. So you're right. But what can we as a church, talking about key, what can we as a church do? Like, what do we need to do to help out and to move towards reconciliation, healing, part of the solution? Do you want to comment on that? And then we'll take some time to pray in a few minutes here, because we talked about doing that. But talk about that, the church and our role.
Yeah, sure. So I just want to go over scripture. Isaiah 1:17 says, learn to do good, seek justice, help the oppressed, defend the cause of the orphans. So we see right here that it's telling us to do good, seek justice, and help out the oppressed. people who are faced with racism are being oppressed. They're being held down from their full potential. And so it's important for the church that the church is able to show love, that, and by being able to show love, meaning that we're able, first of all, to see that there is an issue and that there is a problem. I think one of the biggest issues is that, and even how we start out our conversation, that the people have kind of glanced over this and said, okay, this is not an issue, this is not a problem. And one reason why I'm so happy is the fact that now all over the world, people are addressing this and saying, okay, we've overlooked this for so many years. And just like any other sin, like you can't, sin doesn't go away. You can't overlook it. And so if anything is going to happen, it needs to happen first in the household of God. And so the church needs to, we have to be intentional with our leadership. We have to be intentional with bridging the gaps to other minorities and other groups of people in other communities. We also should be intentional of worshiping together. One thing that I've learned is that different cultures sometimes have different worship styles, and one worship style might be completely different, but God is still pleased. If people are worshiping, you know, God for all that he's done and giving him praise, God is pleased with that. And even donating to the cause. And probably by Sunday, I would love to have up some organizations that people could actually donate to actually help support, and that we're able to make some change. Because at the end of the day, we're all Christians. And on this conversation, we are trying to fulfill the Great Commission, and people want to see love in action. And when we're able to help out our communities, when we're able to help out different nationalities, when we're able to combat racism, we're doing these things. And even multicultural churches, this is one reason why it's been such a big thing on my heart to plant a multicultural church in the city, is because this is a multicultural community. And when people, they have exposure, they're able to operate in love, and fear breaks down. Now we're able to send out healthy Christians out in the community who are able to impact so many others. Even early in the conversation, I was talking about possibly tutoring, getting out, mentoring. I mean, these are areas and ways for us as the church to kind of combat this thing. And the most important thing is to call it out for what it is. You know, that it is something that God is not pleased with. That we all bleed one blood, one color, which is red. And so God wants us to come together, and he wants us to unify. And I believe once the church is able to do that more often, then we will see so much change, so much transition. And the Holy Spirit wants to do so much, and he wants to flow through us. So working with leadership and all these other things, we're able to combat it in these ways and operate in love. God's ready. He wants to do some big things.
Yeah. And you know, on that note, because you're right. And we will, mm-hmm. like at the end of this video, mm-hmm. Or at least somewhere on the website or, you know, through social media, we will make sure that we communicate, because there are some organizations that I've done some research on that I think would be good for, you know, my church to look at, and to just, you know, again, just to understand the conversation more and more, and to lean in and to really listen. There's a incredible message that I want them to watch from with Steve Furtick and Elevation Church and yes. John Gray. And I mentioned that to you this week. What a powerful 1 hour message that will change your life. That really just, it's just powerful. I don't want to say anything too much, because I don't want to make it sound any less than, like, it is just really, really good. And so I'll put that link up. It might even show up on the screen here in this moment. But just that very thought, and I want to go to prayer today. And you know, you just mentioned it about our role as followers of Jesus. And you know, last week in the end of our Walking Wounded series, I mentioned Romans chapter 12, and talking about the importance of, you know, knowing our value and that kind of stuff. But if you go a little further on, you know, Paul reiterates the very thing that Isaiah prophesied, right, about, you know, doing what is right, what is just, you know, and it's about, you know, not overcoming, you know, evil with evil, and it's about loving one another, living in harmony with one another, building each other up, all of that kind of stuff. And I want to end on this quote, and then Jason, if there's something else that you want to share, that's fine, but I would like to lead us in a time of of prayer, because I would love to invite you to pray for us as a community, as a church, that we would learn to listen more and to, like I said, lean in and to find ways to be a part of the solution, and that the Holy Spirit will lead us and guide us in those things. And I want to pray, because maybe someone's watching this today and maybe they're going, man, I didn't realize that maybe I do have some prejudice and maybe I do have some bias, and, you know, or maybe I have done some things that would be considered discriminatory. I don't know. And that's not to say that you are, if you're watching this. I'm just saying that it's important for all of us to search, allow God to search our heart in any matter. And you mentioned that, right? Like, sin is sin. So we don't want any of that to be inside of our hearts. And we're living with a world that is broken. And that's the thing that I want to highlight, that this, at the root of this, really is about brokenness and sin, original sin. And there was a professor out of Wheaton College, an assistant professor of communication at Wheaton College, that was writing in Christianity Today. His name is Dr. Theon Hill. He's a black man. He was at some of the protests where he lives, and God just struck something inside of his heart, and I want to end with this. He said this: everything became clearer for me. Suddenly, I understood experientially the mindset that motivated Martin Luther King Jr.'s prophetic declaration, America, you must be born again. And this is not just about America. This is about humanity. We must be born again in a country, listen to this, in a country built on exploitation, oppression, and discrimination, social transformation depends on a revolution of values. Our national values could not prevent the genocide of Native American brothers and sisters, the enslavement of African captives, and the exploitation of Chinese railroad workers. They remain insufficient for our current crisis. The revolutionary values we cannot that we need cannot be located in the Declaration of the Declaration of Independence or the U.S. Constitution. They can only, I love this, they can only be found in the God of the Bible, who hates injustice, loves mercy, and cares for the oppressed. And I read that and I was like,
it's good.
Wow. And so I'm going to start by praying today for any of us that just that prayer of God, search our heart and help us to grasp the steps that we can take to help be a part of the solution and bring reconciliation and healing, as we're called to and mandated by Scripture. That's who we take our cue from, the Word of God. And then, Jason, I'm going to invite you to pray for us, and then we'll close. So, Father, I just take a moment for every person that's watching this. I invite them in this moment, Holy Spirit, may we really hear not only what our brothers and sisters are communicating, that part of our body, our family, part of humanity that has wrestled through racism. And again, you know, many nations, many races around the world have suffered for it. And so, God, we want to search our hearts. And God, if there is any prejudice within us, if there's any bias within us that, God, we're not even aware of, God, maybe we've done some things or said some things that, God, are not honoring to you, or honoring to your word, or honoring and really has caused our inability to live in harmony with our brothers and sisters. I pray, Father God, that we would be quick to repent, and that, Holy Spirit, you would also enlighten us. And that, Holy Spirit, you would lead us and guide us, that we would be led and guided by the love of God, that we would show mercy, that, God, we would be a voice, that, God, we would together work towards the solution. So, Holy Spirit, lead us and guide us today. We invite you in Jesus' name.
God, we just bless you, Lord, and Lord God, we know, we understand, Lord, that you are love, and you told us to walk in perfect love. That is your desire for us. God, I'm praying, Lord, for Community Church, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord, already by faith, God, for giving them the grace and the ability, Lord, to see and understand, God, to work in their community, Lord, that if even for anyone who is there, Lord, even as King David said, to search our hearts, Father, I pray, Lord, that they would search their hearts deep, God, and if there's any root of bitterness, racism, or or hate God. I thank you, Lord, for removing it out, Lord. And the reason why you tell us to search our hearts, God, is for the Holy Spirit to bring up to the surface in areas, God, that we must change, that we must have a renewed mind, Lord, that we would be born again, that we would be completely renewed and completely fresh. God, I thank you, because when I think about Romans 12, I think about when you ask us to be renewed by the mind, for our minds to be renovated. Lord, we speak, God, that minds would be renovated, that they would be healed, and that they would be repaired. God, Lord, I'm just praying and thanking you already, Lord, that lives would be changed, God, because of our obedience, Lord, because the sin of racism, God, is not who we are. It's not who you've called us to be by your blood. And we bless you and we thank you, Lord. I pray, God, that they would walk in your authority, Lord, that they would walk and be completely free, and that they would impact other people, Lord. God, I thank you, Lord, that we would, that the church would walk in unity everywhere, Lord, that people would come together, Lord, that everything would be repaired, that bandages and hurts and pains would be repaired, Lord, and that this church would walk forward in your strength, God, and that they would bring justice, that they would go and call out social injustice, but most of all, God, that they would operate in your authority and showing love and helping out the community and letting them know and understand that social injustice is something that the church is looking at and going over, Lord. But most of all, with you, God, your love and your goodness is going to carry them over, Lord, as they're here to impact the community. I bless you and I thank you for that, God. And that their reach would be greater in the greater Toronto area. So we thank you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, listen, my friend and brother, I mean that. You know that, man. Like I said, from day one, we felt like kindred spirit, man. Right. We just connected. We love you and Delaby, and we speak blessing over you guys. And thank you so much, man, for joining us today as we lean in and listen. And for everyone that's out there watching this, this is Community Church, and you need to know this for sure today. This is your place to belong.